praise God. Wonderful worship set already. Great time just coming together and being in God's presence and worshiping Him. Praise Him for what He's done already this morning. Well, I hope you have a Bible with you this morning. If you don't, feel free to grab one off of underneath one of the chairs in front of you. And if you just need to borrow it for today, that's fine. If you need to take one home, if you don't have a Bible at home and you need to take one of those with you, feel free to do that. That's what they're there for. So take out your Bible or device or whatever you got with you this morning. Turn with me to Romans chapter 3. That's where we're going to be as we're continuing our journey through Romans. We're going to be in chapter 3 this morning. And as you're turning there, let me just mention this. Many of you are probably too young to remember this, but when it was turning from the year 1999 to the year 2000, there was a great deal of uncertainty. I know you're smiling about this. A great deal of uncertainty about what was going to happen. Now, the Y2K scare, as it's become known, it seems all rather silly now, but it was serious business then. See, the internal memory of most computers up to that point, all of the date fields were just two digits. Two digits for the day, two digits for the month, two digits for the year. And so nobody had any idea what was going to happen when that internal clock ticked over to 2000. Nobody knew, would the computer recognize it as 2000 or would it think it was 1900? Now, for most of us that are sending emails and that kind of stuff, it was no big deal. But many people feared the consequences, the implications of that. Would that disrupt utilities or deliveries that were based on that timestamp? What kind of effect would that have on the banking industry, the transportation industry, things that are absolutely dependent on that time schedule? What kind of impact would that have? And all the chaos you can imagine if those things were impacted in a grand scale, all of the chaos that would bring. Now, it turned out in the end to be just a much ado about nothing. A little tweak here, a little patch there, and all was well. But that could have been a problem of epidemic proportions. Well, as I mentioned, we're continuing in our journey of growing together through the book of Romans. And we come face to face here in chapter 3 with a deadly epidemic that is completely different than the Y2K scare. This one is real. And it affects all of us, and there's no amount of tweaking, there's no amount of patching that's going to impact this one at all. Now, last week, as we started this study, we were in chapter 1 last week, and we looked at that sort of extended discussion that Paul was giving there. He started there in the latter part of chapter 1. This extended discussion of sin and God's reaction to it. And that discussion lasts all the way through chapter 1, all the way through chapter 2, and right up to verse 8, of chapter 3. And you remember I mentioned to you last week to check out on the website the sermon schedule. You can see where this series is going. And I encourage you, read ahead. See where we're going to go next and read ahead. So you can come on Sunday morning with a little bit of a sense of anticipation. Hey, I read that this week. I wonder what that meant or the implications of that. Or boy, I sure hope he talks a little bit about that particular phrase that Paul used. And if I don't address something that you see in that text, I invite you to put that question up on the church Facebook page and ask it, and I'll be glad to answer it there. I think a lot of times we come to church, and you just sort of nod and let me know if this has been your experience. We come to church, and we look around, and we think everybody else has got all the answers already, right? You see people nodding their head during the sermon or taking notes, and you think, everybody here already has all the answers. They already understand all of this, and they've got their life together, but I'm the only one here that seems to not know what's going on or have questions. Does that happen to you? I think most of us at some point in time have felt that way, that I'm the only one here that doesn't have the question or that has questions. But let me assure you that's not the case. And so don't be afraid to ask your questions. Put them up on the Facebook page. I guarantee you there's somebody else sitting in the congregation that morning that had that very same question that was just afraid to ask. So I encourage you to follow ahead so you know where we're going. And this morning we're going to pick this up in verse 9 of chapter 3. And Paul really is turning the corner. He ends this lengthy discussion about sin and its consequences. And then his conclusion really starts there in verse 9. And he's turning a corner from the bad news, and now he's starting to make his way around the corner to the good news. What is the answer to all of this? And here's the big idea, these last verses of chapter 3. That though sin is a deadly epidemic, God has provided the cure, because we just simply can't. Now, in order for him to get to that point, we know that when it comes to this kind of situation, for God to provide the cure for this deadly epidemic, God has to see it clearly. God's got to see the situation for what it is. And that's the reality. That when it comes to our relationship to sin, God sees it clearly. He's always seen it clearly. One of my favorite movies is A Few Good Men. Remember back early 90s, a very young Tom Cruise, a younger Jack Nicholson. I don't know if there was ever a point in time he actually was young, but younger certainly in that movie when he could still fit into a Marine uniform. There's a scene early on in the movie. Tom Cruise's character, he's a lawyer. He's just been assigned as the defense counsel for the accused. And he's gone to get briefed by Demi Moore's character. She's going to brief him on the facts of the case. She talks to him for about 30 seconds, and he says, 12 years. He said, I'll get them to admit to conspiracy to commit murder, 12 years in prison. And she says, you haven't looked at a piece of evidence or interviewed a witness. And he's pretty proud of himself. He said, pretty good, huh? And she said, oh, no, you're going to have to look deeper than that. But you know, that's the reality, right? When we just look at the surface of something, we often miss what is really going on. We can look at the surface of our own lives or look at the surface of other people's lives, and we miss what's really happening below the surface if we just look at what we see up front. But God has always seen it. When it comes to this issue of sin and its impact in our lives, God has always seen it. Let's pick up there in verse 9 of chapter 3. What then? Again, he's a concluding statement. He's made this long argument about sin, its consequences, and the fact that we are all without excuse. That's a phrase he repeated several times, you remember. What then? Are we better than they? Not at all. For we have already charged that both Jews and Greeks are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, not even one. There's none who understands and none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they've become useless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave, and with their tongues they keep deceiving. The poison of asps is on their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their paths, and in the path of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. I say, well, that's kind of a dark list, right? That's kind of a dark assessment of the situation. Now, he's not suggesting there that people who don't know Christ never do anything worthwhile. That's not what he means by saying that there's none who understands, none who seeks after God, they're completely useless, none who does good. He's not suggesting that to the person that doesn't know Christ, everything they do in their life is absolutely worthless. They can't do a good deed. That's not his suggestion. There is the capacity to do some good things in the absolute worst of us. But at the same time, there is the capacity to do some frightening evil in the absolute best of us. And so he's not suggesting that. But this is the state of things from God's perspective. As God looks down on the world and sees to the heart of man, far beyond the facade that we put on, far beyond the mask that we might wear day to day in front of other people, or here we wear it even to church sometimes. God sees through all of that, and when God looks down, this is what it looks like from his perspective, the spiritual condition of man. That's what he's talking about. Verses 10 through 18 there, that's a series of quotes from the Old Testament. Now, you can tell that in most English Bibles when they're quoting the Old Testament verbatim. It's set off somehow. In my Bible, it's in all caps, and it might be in italics in yours, or it might be in quotes or something, but there's some way you can tell in the New Testament when they're quoting the Old Testament. It'll be set off somehow from the rest of the text. This is a long quote. Verses 10 through 18 is a series of quotes from the Old Testament. Verses 10 and 11 are from Psalm 14. And he quotes almost, Psalm 14, verses 1 through 3, he quotes it almost in its entirety. But I want to read it in its entirety. Psalm 14, verses 1 through 3. You can look at, you'll see the similarities between verses 10 and 11 and the beginning of verse 12. But I think when we read it, the entire thing together out of Psalm 14, we really get a sense of the point that he's trying to make here. This is what it says in Psalm 14. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. Their deeds are vile. There is no one who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven on all mankind to see if there are any who understand, any who seek God. But all have turned away. All have become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one. And when we read it out of Psalms, we read the entire thing, get the context of really what he's saying. We see that phrase there in the middle that God looks down into the heart of man, and this is his assessment. This is when God looks at us, this is what he sees. And notice how Paul describes that in verse number 9. He said, we are under sin. Now that's a significant phrase. That really gives us a sense of when God is looking down from heaven and he's peering into the heart of man, what does he see? Paul says that we are under sin. Like we're under a spell. That's kind of the same connotation. You know, then to stir that up in your mind. If sin moves us in directions that we shouldn't go. We sang in that song just a few minutes ago. We've all gotten into things that we know just ain't right. Sin does that. It drives us. It moves, compels us in a direction that we know we shouldn't go. The wording of verse 1 in Psalm 14 in the original language read this way. The fool says in his heart, no, God. And we can see that progression, the same progression he's talking about in chapter 1 where this sort of slow, steady progression of turning away from God and to us as the center of everything, going from worshiping God as the creator to worshiping the creation. We see that same pattern. The fool says in his heart, no, God. And the fool says, there is no God. Finally, the fool says, I am God. And we see that same turning away. That's what God sees when he looks down into the heart of man. And it's not just that people commit sins. This phrase that we are under sin, it's not just that we commit sins, that, like it's some occasional problem. Well, I'm not perfect. Right? After all, I'm just human. I make mistakes like everybody else. It's not just that we commit sins like it's some occasional thing that happens in our lives. It's not even that we're all sinners. That yes, this is a pervasive condition that all of us have that periodically rears its ugly head in our lives. It's not even that. He says we're under sin. It's this language of domination, right? That's kind of what it sounds like. Like sin's got us under its thumb, and there's no way we can escape from that. It's this language of domination. Over in chapter 6, verse 20, we're going to see this when we get to chapter 6, he said we're slaves to sin. You know, a slave doesn't get to say what happens to them. Their master says, go there, and the slave has to go. Their master says, when you get there, do this, and the slave has to do it. There's no vote. There's no democracy. The slave is absolutely beholden to whatever its master tells it to do. And he said, that's the condition when we're under sin. It drags us places that we might, in our heart and our minds, know, I shouldn't be here. Ever had that happen to you? I know I shouldn't be doing this. Even while you're doing this, I know I shouldn't be doing this, but there's something about that has drugged me over here, and yet here I am. And that's the condition as God looks at us. We're slaves to sin and we absolutely can't resist it. And many times we don't want to. Paul's speaking to Timothy, writing to him, 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 24. He talks about the fact that sin goes before us. And some sin follows in behind us. And there's this idea that we are absolutely engulfed in it. And listen, when the eyes of God look down from heaven into the heart of man, he sees this. And we can hide it from each other. We can even hide it from ourselves and say, you know, I'm not that bad a person. I'm not as bad as these other guys I know at work. I'm not as bad as some people I can think of. We can hide it. We can try to justify it. But when God looks down into the heart of man, he sees it clearly. He sees this problem clearly. And here's his point. It's not just Paul's judgment of the situation. It doesn't really matter what Paul thinks of us, right? It doesn't matter what he thinks of our lives, the condition of our hearts. It's not Paul's judgment of the situation. It's not my judgment or your judgment at the end of the day that's going to matter. None of us is going to stand in judgment before the other. It's not my judgment or your judgment of the situation that matters. God sees it. God sees it clearly. And it's his judgment. Only his judgment is the only one that matters. comes to this issue of this deadly epidemic, and he starts to turn this corner even, and he's going to talk about the good news. He's got to establish that, first of all, God sees it clearly. But he not only sees it clearly, he shows it convincingly. Twice this week, I was asked a question about why the Old Testament matters to us now. Now, I can guarantee this, if you haven't asked that question out loud, you've had it up here. We are New Testament believers. We live in a time of the New Covenant. What is the story with the Old Testament, all these strange laws and rules and this and that? Why do we even care about the Old Testament anymore? How does that apply to us now? And I guarantee that all of us at some point in time have had that question. And it's a valid question. Because there are things in the Old Testament that we don't follow today. Some of those ceremonial laws, we don't follow those today. And there's a lot of things in the Old Testament that are just quite frankly weird and foreign to our culture. Talking about my ox goring my neighbor's ox, and neither of us have an ox. What am I supposed to do with that? Comes to verses 19 and 20. He's really revealing the answer. Now, he's not revealing it to them. They knew very well the applicability of the Old Testament. You remember, as Paul was writing this, there was no New Testament. You know, what Paul was writing to them would become part of the New Testament. In a very real way, Paul and the other apostles, the disciples of Christ, they were the New Testament. Their experiences as the disciples followed after Jesus, those became the Gospels as we know them. And the things as Paul interacted with the churches and interacted with other believers and talked to them and discipled them about how to follow after Christ on a day-to-day basis, that became a big chunk of the New Testament. In a very real way, they were the New Testament. But here's something that's amazing about the Word of God. That Paul's response to a first century audience that didn't really need any explanation about the applicability of the law and the applicability of the Old Testament. His response to a first century audience still speaks to us in a very relevant way, a 21st century audience. And he addresses this issue of what are we to do with the law? Now, he doesn't answer it completely, but it really in the context of this discussion of sin and its consequences. Verse 19, he's really looking back to that day when God gave the law to Moses. When God took his finger and carved into those tablets the Ten Commandments there on Mount Sinai, he's pointing back to that. Look there at verse 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. And he draws to their mind that day when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with those tablets with the Ten Commandments on it, and he gave them. God gave his law to the children of Israel. Those under the law, he's talking about the Jews. And he calls that to their mind. But I think that brings up another question, doesn't it? If he's bringing this image to their mind, when God gave the Ten Commandments to the Jews, those under the law, how can he say what he says at the end of verse 19? Every mouth then will be closed. All of the world has become accountable. This law was given to the Jews. How does that apply to us? We're not those that were under the law, and I think it begs that second question. But here's why he can say that. Verse 20 is why he can say that. Because by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. See, one of the major lessons of the Old Testament, one of our takeaways today as we look back in the Old Testament, we said there's some things there that we don't quite get. Some cultural gaps that are maybe too big for us to step across. But here's a major lesson of the Old Testament, is that it shows God's faithfulness to his people. It shows God's unending, unchanging love for his people, despite their lack of ability to keep the law. In fact, that was the reason why he gave it in the first place, so that he could show it to us convincingly. There would be no question at the end that God's assessment of things is right. We can see it in a very real way. That was why he gave the law. Galatians chapter 3, verse 24. Paul said that the law had become our tutor to lead us to Christ. So that we could see it as God gave that law and it touched every aspect of life. We think of the big issues. I'm obedient to God's law mostly. Never killed anybody. You know, we always kind of go to the big stuff, right? The easy stuff, low-hanging fruit. Never killed anybody. I've not cheated on my spouse. Okay, so we go to the big issues, right? But the law spoke to every matter of their lives. In every little encounter they would have, God had requirements for them. And when we look at the law in its totality, we say, I don't understand all of it, but here's the clear message. I don't meet it. Listen, if God's expectation of me is to be perfect, not just in the big muscle movements of life, but in every single moment of life, we can't help but to see how far we fall short. That's why he gave the law. It was a clear, here's what I expect of you, and a clear lesson for us to say, and here's how far short you fall. In fact, Paul says over in Romans chapter 7, if it wasn't for the law, I wouldn't have even known what sin was. God was showing us his expectations so that we could see it. In fact, he says here in verse 21 of Romans chapter 3, he said that God's righteousness apart from the law has been manifested to us. That word manifest is the same word he used over in chapter 1 verse 19 where he said that God made his presence evident to us. Obvious. When we see the law and what it required, it's obvious to us how far we fall short of that mark. See, God saw the problem clearly. But if we're going to respond to it, it's not enough just that he saw it and he understood it and he saw to the heart of man and said, you're painfully short. If we're going to respond to it, we had to see it. We had to see it in a way that we couldn't respond to. And he showed it completely in such a way that every mouth will be closed. There's no debate. We won't be able to stand before God and debate that matter. Yeah, you know, God, I kept a lot of your law. I kept a good bit of it. We won't be able to debate that before God. There won't be a time for us to argue with God or to yeah, but with God. We stand before the perfect standard of the law, we see it that quickly, how far short we fell of it. Because here's the thing, until we get to that point, God sees it. He knew it all along from the moment before Eve took that fruit from the tree and ate it. God saw the problem. He's always seen it. But before we're going to respond to the issue, we've got to see it. Before we can get to what God does next, as Paul turns the corner to the good news. God saw it clearly. He showed it to us convincingly, and then he solved it completely. But you and I aren't ready for it to be solved completely until we see it convincingly. Now, if the law just shows us how far off the mark we are, then we're in quite a pickle, aren't we? Because those are the things that we're supposed to do. This is the perfect expectation of God. And if the only thing that the only good of the law was to show us how far short we fell of it, well, we're in quite a pickle. Because that's all I can do, and I can't quite get there from here. I never will be able to. The solution had to come from outside of us. The solution had to come from outside of man. The solution had to come from God. There was no other way. Those Old Testament sacrifices. And we look through the Old Testament, we see all these sacrifices, different sacrifice for this, a different offering for that, and we see this extended list of different things. And all of those Old Testament sacrifices, they only dealt with the symptoms of the problem, the sins that they committed with their hands, so to speak. That's what the Old Testament sacrifices dealt with. The immediacy of the forgiveness I need for doing this one thing. What they did not do was deal with the sin that was in their hearts. The cause of all of that. You remember we looked last week as we're there in Romans chapter 1, and we saw these. He has a specific example he holds up. Exhibit A, I called it. The issue of homosexuality he talks about in Romans chapter 1. And you remember I said, you know, in all actuality, you could take almost any habitual sin and plug that into what Paul's saying there in Romans chapter 1, and God's reaction to it would be exactly the same. He's really holding that up as exhibit A. Do you see a life that's committed to sin looks like, the devastating effects of that? And the problem is it's a heart matter. All of those things are symptoms. What he's talking about in Romans chapter 1, that's a symptom of a problem. Those Old Testament sacrifices, they dealt with individual sins. They were band-aids on the symptoms. They never really dealt with the cause, the underlying disease that was there. In fact, the Hebrew writer said, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1, he said, all of that was just a shadow of the things to come, pointed us forward to the fact that one day God's going to have to deal with the sin issue in our hearts, because I can't get there from here. And then the Hebrew writer goes on to say, verse 12 of Hebrews 10, but Jesus offered one sacrifice for the sins of all time. It's effective for every sin, and it's available for every person. God solved the problem completely when his son came to this earth, took on the form of a man, lived a perfect life, and died on the cross to pay that penalty for sin that you and I owe. God solved it. One sacrifice for sins for all time. And notice he says there in verse 22 that it's for all who believe, for there is no distinction. Now, we often use this section of Romans chapter 3 in an evangelistic way, Romans 3:23 especially, and it's got that application. But he was writing to the church. He was writing to them in a very encouraging way to encourage them about what God had done for them. And he said, listen, it's for all who believe, there is no distinction. No matter who you are, no matter what you have done, no matter what you have not done, this is for you. And you might be sitting there this morning thinking, yeah, but you don't know what I've done. Pastor, you have no idea what I've gotten myself into in this life or the things that I have done in the past. You don't know. And you're right. I don't know. But God knows. And look what he says there in verse 23. He knows what you've done. He knows where you've been. He knows who you have been. But then look what he says in verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Listen, God knows full well who you are. He knows. He's known you from before the moment he knit you together in your mother's womb. He's known everything about you. God is under no delusions about who you are, about who you were, about who you will be. God is under no delusions when he made this promise. He knows us to a level of depth that we don't know ourselves. And then he made this promise in verse 24. Knowing full well who you are, that you can be justified as a gift by his grace through redemption which is in Christ Jesus. I mentioned last week that no matter how far down that dark, deep hole sin has taken you, that God's love can reach you there. God knows full well who you are and who you will be, and yet he made this promise anyway, that all of us can be redeemed. And he uses that word justified, and we'll get to that more when we get to Romans chapter 5. It's a major theme of Paul's letter to the Romans. We'll deal with it more when we get to chapter 5. But it means this, quite simply. It means to be declared not guilty. Acquitted. That's how we would talk about it in the courts. It means to be declared not guilty. It's not that God forgets our sins and pretends that we're innocent. You know, I just love you enough, I'm going to pretend you've never done anything wrong. That's not what justified means. But when we trust in Christ and we accept his work on the cross as sufficient to pay for our sins, what that means is that when God looks at us, he sees his son. That's all he sees. And he sees us as not guilty. It's not that we are not guilty. That's the way God sees us in Christ. Now, how's that work? I heard one pastor describe it like this. We're in the courtroom, right? And all of us are the defendants. And God is the judge up behind the bench there. And the trial goes on and all of the evidence is presented. And God at the end of the trial takes the gavel, he pounds it on the bench, and he says, you're guilty. The penalty is death. And then he gets up from behind the bench. He takes off his robe. He comes around to the front, and puts his arm on your shoulder. And he says, but I'll take the punishment for you. Sin's a deadly epidemic. It's something that affects each and every one of us. But God has provided the cure because there is no other way. Now, to be saved doesn't mean we're better than anyone else. In fact, that's the way he started this section in verse 9, you remember. What then? Are we better than them? He said, absolutely not. It doesn't mean that we're better than anyone else. The reality is that every one of us in this world is just a beggar. A beggar desperately looking for bread. And Jesus said he's the bread of life. The one who was saved is really just one beggar showing another beggar where to find bread. And maybe you're here this morning and you've been running. You've been seeking and you've been searching for the answer. Here it is. That you and I are sinners who fall painfully short of God's expectation every single day. There's nothing we can do about that. But God in his love for us sent his son to come and live a perfect life, die on the cross, pay the penalty for our sins, that you and I might be made right with God. That's the reality. Maybe you're searching for the answer. That's what it is. And all we have to do is accept that gift. The question is, will you? Let's pray together. Father, thank you. You are an amazing, amazing God. We think about when you look down at the heart of man and you see the dark, dark condition. And yet, in the midst of that, you sent your son Jesus for us. Your most very precious one to save those who had no time for you. What an amazing love, amazing grace, amazing mercy. Fathers, we've opened up your word today and we've seen this deadly epidemic and how you have dealt with it, how we can be made right with you. Father, I pray as your spirit has spoken to us at this place this morning, Lord. You've spoken to the heart of one here today. As we enter this time of invitation, this time of response, Lord, I pray you continue to stir in their hearts the need to just settle this matter once and for all, to experience forgiveness and be reconciled unto you. You've spoken to many other hearts in many other ways this morning, Lord, and as we continue this into this time of invitation, would you continue to speak to us and help us to respond to you? We pray in Jesus' name.